We have such busy lives and so many things going on around us. That's why it's important to pray. That's why Jesus got away. He got away often, amen?
Amen.
Y'all know the life of Christ? A little warm in here for y'all? That after he ministered, after he was around the disciples, many of times he would leave the disciples and go to the Mount of Olives where he visited often, and he would seek the Father and he would pray. Why is it so important? He was the Word that was manifested. He was God himself. Amen?
Amen.
Wrapped
Amen.
In flesh. So if Jesus had to pray, how much more do we have to pray?
Amen. Amen.
As a body of believers, prayer for the Christian is our lifeline.
Amen.
It's the blood which pumps through your veins to keep you alive is your prayer life. Everybody
Amen.
With me?
Amen.
Amen. Without prayer, you cannot walk victoriously in the Spirit. Your prayer life has to be daily.
Amen.
Not just on Sunday. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The Bible does say, do not forsake the assembling of yourselves that we have come here today so that we can get under the word.
Amen.
For Jesus said, when I go away, I'm going to send gifts unto the church, which is the fivefold ministry. Apostle, prophet, teacher, evangelist, and pastor. Their job is to equip the saints for what? For service in the kingdom. Amen?
Amen.
For service for the world in the sense that you go and you become a light in a dark world.
Amen.
You become the salt that seasons the earth. Amen?
Amen.
But what good is the salt if it's lost its flavor, if it's lost its seasoning? It's good for nothing but to be tossed out and trampled under feet.
Amen.
Amen.
How does the salt stay seasoned? How do you stay, as they say, when you're in the military and you're going to overtake something, it says, they say, stay salty. Stay salty. The whole revelation behind that is that you cannot lose being salty to season that which is around you so it tastes good. Salt added to food makes the food taste good. Amen?
Amen.
We are that salt in the earth because sin is running rampant. We're in the last days. We cause the earth with the saints in it to be tolerable. When others see us, they should see Christ in us, the hope of glory.
Amen.
Hallelujah. When they encounter us, they should encounter Jesus Christ in us. That salt. As they begin to encounter you, as they begin to know you, they discover that there's a seasoning behind you that tastes good. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And they want some more of that. You taste something that's good, you want more of it. Amen?
Amen.
That should be the believer in these last days when they get around you, that your saltiness hasn't lost its flavor.
Amen.
And how do we do that? It's not a, let's do an X, Y, Z equals 25, make it real complicated. It's simple. Stay hooked up to the vine. Your prayer life, your word life has to be daily. Apostle Paul says, daily, daily, not part-time, but daily I seek the Lord with my whole heart. Everything that is in you must be after God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Everything should take second place, third place, and fourth place. He should be on the throne of your heart. That's my heart's prayer for you in 2015. If there's anything crowding out, Jesus being on the throne of your heart.
Amen.
Let's say, Lord, I'm going to start to put things in decency and in order. And you're going to be first in my life.
Amen.
We'll have to make some commitments. We'll have to give up some things. Everybody in Houston, Texas enjoys football. Hallelujah.
Amen.
We're football city. Amen. You being here, knowing Sunday, there's some games that start on Sunday. And you have to give up some of your time. You have to sacrifice some of your time being in church on Sunday.
Amen.
I know we have DVR. We can record it. But it's just not the same when it's live, right? I want to be there when everybody else is there watching it so I know that I'm there experiencing it live with everyone else. Hallelujah. What does that tell God, no matter what's coming on Sunday, That when you're here, knowing that what you love is playing, but you sacrifice it because you want to be in the house of God.
Hallelujah.
That says a lot. And that says a lot to what comes first in your heart.
Amen.
Nothing wrong with enjoying football and enjoying the things that are in this earth, but not to the point that it takes up residence. Right. It takes up housing and it takes first place over everything.
Amen.
That could be with a relationship. It could be with money. It could be anything that takes the place of God in your life. Hallelujah.
Amen.
No one person or thing can fill you up and make you whole except the Lord Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
When you as a believer, you as a man or a woman in the earth, when you start to feel like something is missing in your life, you're like, there just feels like something is missing. I'm not whole. I feel incomplete. I'm retired. I have money. I have a job. You know, I have a loved one. I'm married. Everything seems to be in its right place. You have a nice home. You have food in the refrigerator. You have food in your belly. Amen? But there's still something missing. The only one that can fill up that space in your heart is going to be God. It's going to be the Lord Jesus. You cannot find your identity in something else. It can only be in the Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. That's not the word today, but somebody needed to hear that. Hallelujah.
Amen.
We're going to complete our message today. We should complete it. We're talking about Don't Think It Strange is the title of the message. Don't Think It Strange is the second part of the message we started last Sunday. And we can all turn to 1 Peter chapter 4. Get excited.
Amen.
Get excited this morning. Hallelujah. You can get excited in the house of God. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. You're here. You made it through the rain and the cold. You know, it rains in Houston. People don't come out of their houses. Especially when it's cold. Houstonians go in and they cover up and they're not coming out.
That's right.
But I guarantee you, if it was something they wanted to do, they would be in that car and they would be on the road and they'd be going to that event. Am I speaking the truth? I remember many of times going to Mardi Gras and it was storming outside. And I got in that car and I went to Galveston because I was going to party. Hallelujah. But because it's the house of God, well, we can just go ahead and just put it to the side and just wait till next Sunday. They're going to be there again next Sunday. But maybe today was your miracle.
Amen.
Maybe today God was going to move on your situation.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So for whatever reason, hear pastor when he's saying this to you. Unless you're sick, use wisdom, stay home, pray. If it's your faith to come into the house of God, even though you're sick, that's between you and the Lord. But we use wisdom around here. Amen.
Amen.
Come on now. That's good stuff. Let's go to 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12. We're talking about don't think it strange. Don't think it strange. Why did Apostle Peter say that to the believers? He was saying that to the believers because he wanted to reassure them that what you're going through in this life isn't strange. When you start to be overtaken with manifold trials and testing doesn't mean that God has abandoned you, that God has forsaken you,
Amen.
That he has left you to your own. He has left you to yourself. Because it does feel like that sometimes. It feels like, God, why am I going through all this hardship? Why am I going through all these trials? Why am I going through all this testing in life? I don't understand. Have I done something wrong? Have I missed it somewhere? So the Christian goes inward and starts checking his heart to make sure everything is in line. Lord, am I in line with your word? Have I been walking obedient?
Amen.
Lord, I don't have any unconfessed sin, which it should alarm the Christian. Amen. When trials come, that should be the first thing you do is keep a close examination on your own heart.
Hallelujah.
To make sure you're in line with God's word. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Come on now. Let's go to verse 12. Are we there? Amen. Don't think it strange if you're going through trials. How many love the word of God? I love the word of God. I love the word of God only on Sundays. Y'all with me? Y'all awake? Come on now. I'm going to step on some toes today. So there's going to be some toe crunching here today. Amen. If the conviction of the Holy Ghost falls upon you, all you have to do is stay really quiet and just keep, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Praise you, Jesus. No one will ever know that you got hit by the Holy Ghost. Remember, a hit dog hollers. You hit a dog, what does he do? Arr! All you got to do is just keep praising with everyone else in the church and you should be fine. Hallelujah. Come on now. That's what the Holy Ghost is here for. He's to help us.
Amen.
To straighten out things that are wrong in our lives. Hallelujah. Amen. We are not complete yet. We're all incomplete. Amen.
Amen.
We're work in progress. Dear friends, Apostle Peter is talking to the church. Dear friends, I speak to the Hand of God ministry. Dear friends, don't be surprised at the fiery trials you are going through, as if something strange were happening to you.
Amen.
He's encouraging the church. He's encouraging the church because the church was going through such intense persecution just for standing for righteousness. Because they decided to say no to the world and say yes to God, you should expect persecution in your life.
Amen.
From loved ones, friends, family, those that don't serve the Lord, be ready to receive persecution. They're not going to understand that you've decided to lay all the fun stuff down. So don't think it's strange, Apostle Peter is saying, when you start going through these types of trials, persecution, things that happen in life, anywhere in here in this verse does it say that don't think it's strange when the devil starts attacking you? This is where Christians get a little unbalanced. The first sign of a trial that hits your home, you want to start rebuking the devil. I bind you, devil. The refrigerator breaks, you're binding the spirit of whatever is attacking your refrigerator. The stove breaks down. The car breaks down. You're laying hands on your car to get the motor to run. Hey, that's your faith, okay? That you want to walk and you have faith to believe that that car is going to turn on. I don't have that kind of faith, I can tell you. I'm going to take it to the mechanic and get it fixed. Hallelujah. To me, it's just loopy. Be careful with those kind of things. What I'm saying is that when a trial hits your life, and it will, it's not if, but when it hits, the trial hits your life, don't be so quick to start blaming Satanás. Amen? Don't start blaming Satan and the enemy. Don't give him that much glory. Amen?
Amen.
It's called life. You take care of it. It is a trial. It can be stressful. It does come along with certain emotions that are attached to it when trials hit your life. But that's where your faith comes in. That's where your relationship with Christ comes in. That's
Amen.
How much word you have in your spirit to be able to sustain that trial that you're going through. Amen.
Hallelujah.
If you don't have the word dwelling in your spirit, you have no nourishment to draw up
Hallelujah.
From the word.
Amen.
No word, no power.
That's right.
No word, no life. Amen. You will drown. Just like Peter, when he stepped out that boat, Jesus said, come on. He told Jesus, bid me to come out of the boat. Jesus said, come on. Come on out the boat. Peter was bold. He was also arrogant. And he thought he knew everything. So he stepped out of the boat and he began to walk on water. And as soon as the storms came on his right and his left, the first thing those storms are designed to do is what?
Take your eyes off of Christ.
Take your eyes off of Jesus. Jesus right there. The storms. Somebody is having problems in their family. The relationships, something's going on over here. You know, mom or dad or sister, brother, family comes in. They'll tell you about the situation, but they don't want to do anything about it. Come on, man. You know the source and you know where the water is. And you've thrown out your line many of times, but yet they want to use you as a trash can. I want to dump all of my things on you, but I don't want to do anything about it, though. Okay, just be a listening ear for me, but I don't want you to tell me anything. Amen? The trial is designed for the believer to take your eyes off of Jesus. Amen?
Yeah.
God wants to see where you are. Wants to separate those things that are unfaithful in your life. Does that make sense?
Amen.
Amen.
When that trial comes, are you going to continue to look towards Christ to get you through and sustain you? And this is how good our Lord is. Even though Peter went down in the water because he looked at the trials and he began to sink, he cried out. He didn't say, guys, in the boat, I need help. James, come save me. That's the first instinct as human beings. We reach out to flesh and blood.
Amen.
Amen.
But because we can see them. They're tangible.
Yeah.
They're going to talk back to us. Amen?
Amen.
We can hear them. The first person Peter cried out was, Lord, save me. And Jesus reached his hand down and pulled him out that water and told him, why so little faith? Why did you doubt? But you know, when he pulled him back up, he did stand back up on that water. And they both walked into the boat.
Wow. Amen.
We may miss it. The trials may knock us down, but you gotta know who to call upon during that trial.
Hallelujah.
You don't call upon everyone else. You call upon the one who can sustain you, and that's Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Is that good?
That's good.
Amen. Let's go to verse 13. That was just verse 12. He said, instead, be very glad. He says, don't think it's strange that the fiery trials you're going through, like something is weird happening to you. He said, instead, be very glad, be joyful, be happy about it, because these trials make you partners with Christ in his suffering so that you will have the wonderful joy of seeing his glory when it's revealed to all the world.
Amen.
He says, the suffering that you're going through now is nothing compared to the glory you shall receive when Jesus Christ comes back to the earth.
Amen.
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 The suffering is just for a little while. The Bible says that when you suffer, watch this now. When you suffer for a little while, he says, I'll pick you up, I'll reestablish you, and I will put you on a firm foundation. That's what the trials do. Amen. They help you to grow and to mature in your faith. But what does verse 14 say? So be happy when you are insulted for being a Christian.
Amen.
You have not lived yet in Christianity if you have not been insulted for being a Christian. What does that mean? That means that there may be some compromise somewhere in your walk with God because you have not said no in the midst of your peers yet. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Amen.
They say, let's go this way. And you say, sure, because you don't want to be persecuted. Though you have the conviction and though your conscious mind is telling you and bearing witness with the Holy Ghost, telling you, don't go along with that. Don't put that in your body. Don't drink this. Don't look at that. Don't go over there. Amen?
Amen.
And yet you do so so that you don't endure persecution, that you don't receive persecution from your peers. Well, I don't want them to say anything about me, so I'm just going to go along and I compromise. Mm-hmm. But what does the Bible say? It says, so be happy when you are insulted for being a Christian, for then the glorious Spirit of God rests upon you. There's times in my walk with God when I first became a Christian and filled with the Holy Spirit that I was persecuted intensely, coming out from the group of friends that I used to hang out with. I didn't have to get rid of my friends. All I did was live for Jesus, and they no longer wanted to be around me. When you start to live for Christ, those around you will start to notice and be ready to suffer when you reject the leading in the wrong direction. Let's keep reading. Getting quiet here. I know nobody wants to get rid of their friends. It gets real quiet when you talk about people's friends. Amen? I've known them since I was 4 years old. And they've been my friend forever, so it just must be right. I can't get rid of them. I don't know where that accent came, but that's just... You know, you are who you are, who you hang out with. Does that make sense?
Amen.
You run with the bad, you're going to be bad. You run with the good, you're going to be good. That good's going to rub off on you. Amen.
Amen.
You don't run with the bad and you're the good and you're going to turn the bad good. Nowhere in the Word it says that. That's why we don't believe in mission dating here in the body of Christ. You're not going to go and see someone who's not saved, get them saved, and start training them so they can be your husband. Or a wife. Find someone who's already equally yoked with you.
Amen.
In verse 15 it says, if you suffer, however, and I love this part. This is where the balance of Apostle Peter is bringing in. He says, if you suffer, however, it must not be for what?
Murder.
Stealing, making trouble. Making trouble means being a busybody, always in people's business. Or prying into other people's affairs. There it is too. So let's back up. If you suffer, however, you get no reward if you're suffering for being a murderer. Apostle Peter is saying that there is suffering that's going to come into the Christian's life. We have someone who suffered, Jesus.
Amen.
He says he bears and he's touched with our infirmities. That means he's touched with our weaknesses. He knows when we're going through suffering. He knows when we're being tempted beyond what we're able to handle. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
He understands when you're going through what you're going through. Don't ever think that you're going through this alone. Because Jesus went through all testing, temptation, yet without any sin. So he knows how to deliver you. He knows how to sustain you. He knows how to strengthen you. All you have to do is call upon the name of Jesus.
Amen.
But the suffering Peter's talking about, don't let it be that kind of suffering that you bring upon by your own hands.
Amen.
That's the kind of suffering that gets no rewards. Hallelujah. That's the sowing and the reaping process, and it's universal. It just doesn't apply to the body of Christ. What you sow, you will reap. The wages of sin is death.
Amen.
You sow to the flesh, you're going to reap destruction of the flesh. Amen. You sow to the Spirit, you're going to reap everlasting life of the Spirit. It promises rewards in the next life and rewards in this life. Amen. Sowing to the Spirit, you reap many benefits. Amen?
Amen.
For the kingdom of God is not meat or drink. It's not meat or drink.
It's not meat or drink.
That's ceremonies. The kingdom of God is not designed with ceremonies. You do X, Y, Z, you're going to be received and in right standings with God. The kingdom of God is not meat or drink, not ceremony or this or that. It's righteousness and right standings with God because of what Jesus Christ has done at the cross.
Amen. Amen.
Righteousness, peace. Then you have peace with God the Father. And you know when you're walking in right standings with God, that peace overpowers you.
Amen.
Have y'all discovered
Amen.
That?
Amen.
When you're walking upright before the Lord and you're doing everything you know, as the word has been revealed to you, you walk in the light. As you receive the light, much given, much required. To that much more given, to that much more required. When the Lord starts to open up your spirit and you have that revelation, God requires of you to walk in it.
Amen.
And then the peace that surpasses all your understanding will guard your heart and mind in Christ Jesus. It's a beautiful thing. Righteousness, peace, and then what's the byproduct, the third part?
The joy.
The joy of the Holy Ghost.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot buy it. You cannot do anything in this earth to get something except through Jesus, the righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Hallelujah. But let's not suffer for doing wrong. Let it be by design. Let it be by design that you are in God and these things are happening. Because the Bible says in Romans 8, let's go there. Y'all gonna like this one. Romans 8. Y'all enjoying that? Y'all enjoying this morning? Is this helping somebody?
Praise God.
Amen.
:828. Every believer should have 828 somewhere. Romans 8:28. The Roman road. When you got it, say you got it. You got it. Now that we got it, we're going to get it and we're going to apply it. Let's do it. Verse 28. Are we there? It says, and we know that God causes everything to work together. Woo!
Amen.
For the good Let's read it again. And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to His purpose for them. That means everything that's happening in your life, God called you according to His purpose. All things work together for His good.
Amen.
Whatever's happening in your life today is by divine design. Amen?
Amen.
There is a design behind what's going on in your life at that moment, but you have to be sensitive to what God is doing.
Amen.
All things work together. All things work together. Well, I don't understand, Pastor. If I fall somewhere, and it's a pretty ugly fall, I was caught in fornication, I was caught in adultery, I was caught whatever. By design, how can God possibly take that and make that work for good? Causes the Christian believer to humble themselves and to seek God for forgiveness and repentance. It
Amen.
Brings them to a lowly state to themselves, so they seek after forgiveness, because God will forgive you.
Amen.
He will restore you. He will refresh you. He will strengthen you. Amen?
Amen.
So all things, doesn't matter what happens, all things work together for them who love God, who are called according to His purpose.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise Jesus. Now that's not a license to go and sin. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that God can use those situations to draw you closer to Him.
Amen.
Go to verse 16. Go back to 1 Peter chapter 4. He says in verse 15, it says, if you suffer, however, it must not be for murder, stealing, making trouble, prying into other people's affairs. That's pretty self-explanatory. Verse 16 says, but it is no shame to suffer for being a Christian. Hallelujah. Praise God for the privilege of being called by His name. Thank you, Lord. So when you're being persecuted, know that you are suffering and it's a privilege. For the time has come, verse 17, for judgment. And it must begin with God's household first. What judgment is he speaking of here? Peter, Apostle Peter, is saying that we are living in the last days and that judgment is at hand. And judgment will go first over the body of Christ. We will not be before the great white throne judgment. Jesus, we will be before the Bema. Everyone who has received Jesus has had their sins washed.
Amen.
And put away.
Amen.
But though you sin again, you must apply that covenant once again.
Amen.
And that means that you must confess your sin. And he's faithful and just to forgive you and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness and restore your fellowship back to God.
Amen.
Don't be fearful, saint, if you miss it, that you're going to lose your salvation.
Amen.
Are you listening
Amen.
To me? What it does, sin breaks fellowship with God. Where the light is, the dark cannot be. If you choose to walk in darkness, no matter how much you confess Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you have no fellowship with God.
Amen.
Amen.
That's just the way it works. That's why the Bible says, do not let sin deceive you, thinking you can walk in sin and yet still confess Jesus Christ and have fellowship with Him, have fellowship with God.
Amen.
There's a crack somewhere. There's a crack in your fellowship. But if you continue to walk in sin, though you have a broken fellowship with God, does that mean that your salvation is lost? No. Remember the prodigal son? He got his father's money. I want my money now. I can't wait till you die. I want it now. Because the son was already in his heart wanting to leave and go back into the world. He was serving at his father's house. And he had experienced the glory of his father's house. And he says, you know what? I don't want to do this anymore. I want to take that money and I want to go off to a far land where no one can see me. A man who isolates himself seeks his own pleasure. Remember that. So he left, went off, spent it on wine, women, and song. until he was broke. That money will eventually run out on that kind of living. Amen? So when he was broke, even the slop that the pigs ate where he was working looked desirable. That's how hungry he was and where he had reached in his state. Now, because he left his father's house did not mean that he stopped being a son. Because I left my father's every day, because I left my dad's house doesn't mean I stopped being his son. Amen?
Amen.
It's good, right? So what happened, he came to himself and realized that I can go back to my father's house. Even the servants are getting something to eat. I'll go back and I will tell my father that I have sinned against him and all of heaven, and that he will receive me back. All things work together for them who love God or are called according to his purpose.
Amen.
Even though he left, and we've had people leave the church. Amen.
Amen.
I want to go back into the world. I just, you know, got around people and things come in, open the doors. Things come in to drag you away. And they realize there's nothing out here. I spent everything I had. I'm in trials. I'm in torment. The enemy is all over me. And I don't want to live like this anymore. I know where the glory is. I know where the river is. I know where my Father is.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
He got up out of there and he started running home. And before he even got to his house, his father saw him and said, compassion filled him, it said. And he ran to meet his son. His son had been gone. Ran, and the first thing that came out of his son's mouth was, forgive me, Father, for I have sinned against you and all of heaven. And before he was going to go into his spill and tell his father all the his apology, he's, oh, stop right there, son. He commanded his servants to come and bring him a royal, the best coat, and put it over him.
Amen.
Put a ring on his finger and put sandals under his feet. For my son was dead and now he is alive.
Hallelujah.
He was lost, but now he's found.
Glory.
Where was the rebuke? Where was the intense judgment that he should have put upon his son? That's our God in heaven. That's our Father in heaven. That's a picture of our Father in heaven. How merciful he is when the sinner decides to turn and walk a different direction.
Amen.
Amen. You cannot just confess sin. You must confess sin and forsake sin and go in a different direction.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And the Father knew it. God knows your heart. God knows when you're ready to get serious with him.
Amen.
And we all must come to that place. I came to that place where my life was going to be taken away from me. And I told the Lord, it was due to drugs and drug deals and things like that. And I said, Lord, I was crying before you. I didn't know much about God. I didn't know much about the Lord. But you all have to realize that we are all born with a God conscience.
Amen.
Because we're still created by God. Though we're not all God's children. We're not God's children until we receive that sacrifice that Jesus made on the cross. Then we have a relationship. He came to redeem that which was lost, Jesus.
Amen.
And the blood reconciles all things. Amen?
Amen.
And I had a knowing of God. And I had a knowing of the Lord. And I cried out to God and said, Lord, you get me out of this. And how many times have we said that? You get me out of this, Father, and I will serve you with my whole heart. I'll lay down, I'll give up my life, and I will serve you. Because I had men coming after my life. And they wanted to kill me. They wanted to take my life. And I cried. I was honest. I was serious when I made that commitment to the Father. And those people are no longer on the earth. They're gone. Did God remove them? I'm not going to attach that to the Father. But I'm going to say this, that he heard my prayer. And I'm here today serving God.
Amen.
And I'm here proclaiming the good news.
Amen.
And I promised and I kept my promise. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Come on now.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Is that good stuff?
Yes.
So we all have a God conscience. Amen? So the young man came back. And his father put a robe on him. It was a royal robe. Those are robes of Jesus. Put a ring on his finger, which represents authority. And put sandals on his feet, knowing that he's always going to be taken care of. That's what the sandals on the feet mean. Every one of us has sandals on our feet. Every one of us have a ring on our finger. And every one of us have a robe in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Stay hooked up to the Lord. Is your salvation secure today? Do you have that security in Jesus? You do, so long as you stay hooked up to Him.
Amen.
There's nothing out there in the world. There isn't. In fact, it's getting worse.
Amen.
Just keep reading. He says, so judgment shall begin in the household with us. And if judgment begins with us, what terrible fate awaits those who have never obeyed God's good news? And also, if the righteous are barely saved, what will happen to godless sinners? We know what's going to happen to godless sinners. There's only two places, heaven and hell. So if you're suffering in a manner that pleases God, keep on doing what is right and trust, there it is, and trust your lives to the God who created you, for He will never fail you.
Amen.
Go with me to Daniel chapter 3. Don't think it strange, the fiery trials that are to try you for the testing of your faith. Hallelujah. It's more precious than gold and silver. But sometimes that heat is so hot, sometimes we can't stand it. But that hot heat is good for us. Daniel chapter 3. Prophet Daniel. We sat under a prophet. His name was Daniel. That's who I grew up under. I didn't understand what prophets were back then. I understood real fast when I walked into his church. It was not a pretty sight. It's not a pretty sight. Coming from a big mega church, used to being in a big church, and my wife first, she got there first, and she was inviting me to this Voice of the Prophet ministry. Oh, just sounded like, this is some godly stuff here, some holy stuff going on here. I didn't know what I put myself into, and came to visit. The man of God is standing up there and calls me up for prayer and started telling me all my business. Things that I was into, that I was covering, and still trying to act like I was serving God. And I understood what a prophet was. Like David. What did Nathan do when he got sent to David? He got sent to David to tell David, you're in unconfessed sin.
Amen.
You need to repent and come out of that. That's what a prophet does. They turn you and put you back on the path towards Jesus. That's why they're not popular. If you're in a prophetic ministry, a true prophetic ministry, you're not going to see a ton of people in there. I walked in there and I said, God surely cannot be in this place. There's like 10 people in here. Where's all the people at? I sat down. First time being there, I said, okay, I see why there's nobody in here. This is a place where they don't play church. They actually walk with God in this place. They serve the Lord in this place.
Oh, my goodness.
Well, I was over at my other church, and boy, I just love to hang out at the coffee house after church and just fellowship till 12 o'clock at night. I thought that was ministry. I thought that was church. Oh, no. I found out real quick that was not church. So there's power in small churches, amen?
Amen.
We are not called to be a mega church here. But if you're looking for your mate, just stick around. God will send them.
Amen.
Though the pickings are small here, I know. But just that's why a lot of people go to those big churches. We have more people. But you're not going to get a godly person. If someone's coming to this ministry, they are serious about their walk with God.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Come on now. It's good stuff, Pastor. We love y'all. We want y'all to grow. Amen.
Amen.
We want y'all blessed. So let's go to verse, we're in Daniel chapter 3.
Mm-hmm.
Let's go to verse 19. Y'all are going to love this. This is King Nebuchadnezzar. He was so furious with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. I was looking at one of the shows yesterday with Medea. I don't know if y'all know Medea. He goes, Mad Shack, Meshach, and the Billy Goat. He was just tearing up the scriptures. He knows the scriptures, you know, that he's a Christian, but it was hilarious. He was trying to explain to a little girl. He goes, and Peter stepped out the boat, and when the whale passed by, and Jonah was in the whale, then Noah came by and picked up Peter out of the boat, and you know, Eve was in that boat. She was in the VIP section. Are you kidding me? That's why y'all have to know the Word of God before y'all go see Bible movies. Amen? Those Bible movies are not scriptural. Hallelujah.
Amen.
We went to see the last one was
Exodus.
Oh, boy. Oh, boy. Make sure you have the Word before you go. I'm not going to forbid you to go, but make sure you have the Word of God in you so that you can spit the bones out and still eat the meat. Yeah. That makes sense? If you're a mature Christian, you know how to spit out the bones. That's not the Lord. That's not the Lord. That's not the Lord. That's God. I can take some of that. But if you're fully filled with the Holy Ghost and you have a lot of the Word of God in your spirit, it's going to bother you. Lord, I just cannot believe they're doing that to the scriptures. What is this? Moses is over here training the people for war? Where's that in the Bible? It's a mess. It is a mess. I'm sorry.
Oh, yeah.
So let's go to Nebuchadnezzar and see what's going on with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. That his face became distorted with rage. Nebuchadnezzar's face became distorted with rage. It was contorting. Because what happened was, I'll do a little backdrop real fast. The king had issued a declaration over the kingdom that this is already the king of Babylon, Nebuchadnezzar. He's not a good king. What happened was, at this point in history, the Israelites had been rebelling for so long. And the prophet had been speaking to them for a long time saying, repent, repent, repent. Come out before destruction hits your home. It's still the same message today. Jesus came up out of that wilderness, and the first thing he said that came out of his mouth was, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand.
Amen.
It's still the same message. Before judgment comes to you. Judgment, what form of judgment comes to the saint? This is the judgment that comes to the saint, and you can read it in chapter 1 of Romans. All God does is give you over to what you're entertaining. If you don't want to come out of, eventually the Lord will give you over to the sin that you're entertaining. Does that make sense?
Amen.
All he does is back up. Yeah. But when that time comes, you got to remember, God is long-suffering.
Amen.
His mercy extends and his grace seems to be inexhaustible. But the Bible says, don't frustrate the grace of God. For we don't know how long. That's why I tell you all the time in this ministry, if you're in sin and you're sowing to the flesh and you have not reaped destruction, it's God's mercy, that's his grace. Get out now.
Amen.
Because it will come. It will come. That's a word for some of you here. Lord says, come out now. It's time to stop and put away those childish things.
Amen.
Got real quiet in here. He says here, so what happened was, he's declaring this in the city. I've set up this statue, this gold statue, and everyone here is going to bow to the statue and worship it. And Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego said, that ain't happening. I'm not about to do that. So they caught him. They caught these three worshiping the Lord. And now they're bringing him before the king to see what they're going to do with him. Okay, so let's see what's going to happen to these guys. So he said in verse 20, he says his face distorted with rage. He commanded that the furnace be heated 7 times hotter than usual. Something's about to happen. Sometimes the furnace in your life will be heated 7 times hotter. Come on now. Then he ordered some of the strongest men of his army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and throw them into the blazing furnace. You see, the king had a little bit of knowledge of who these men were, and he knew of their God. Otherwise, three men, why would he call the strongest men in his army to bind these three? He had a fear somewhere coming in. I better get the strongest men that I have and put this furnace 7 times hotter to make sure that they're going to be killed. The king is about to kill the three men of God here. So they tied them up, threw them into the furnace, fully dressed in their pants, turbans, robes, and other garments. Why were they fully dressed? Because the king knew that if you were fully dressed, you're going to burn quicker. Yeah, that's what it was. So this king, he's pretty angry because they wouldn't bow to his God. So he feels disrespected, and he's doing something about it by executing these three. Let's go to verse 22. And because the king in his anger had demanded such a hot fire in the furnace, the flames killed the soldiers as he threw the three men in. Let me tell you something here, saints. If you're serving the Lord today, and you know without a doubt there's no willful sin in your life right now, then you can rest on the assurance that no evil shall come nigh your dwelling. That's a promise that you can rest on. The one who serves God, the Bible says in Proverbs that their sleep is peaceful at night.
Amen.
Their rest is as of a child. Mm-hmm. And they wake up strong and encouraged because they know the one whom they serve.
Amen.
But you have to know the promises of God. They have to be concrete in your heart, so that you can draw nourishment from the word. No word, like I said, no power, no promises, no rest, no peace for your soul. Amen?
Amen?
If you trust God, you have to trust in what his word says and rest in what his word says.
Amen.
And leave the rest in God's hands. Here it is, these men that were throwing into the fire, they're the ones that got burned. If someone's trying to set up a booby trap for you, and booby trap, the proverb says that they're going to be booby trapped.
Yeah, amen.
It says when they throw a boomerang and they're trying to hit you, the boomerang misses them and it comes back to them.
Amen.
Y'all ought to read y'all's Bible. It's fun. I'm getting all this from the Bible, and some of y'all are like, wow, that's good. Do they have that on video? No, you got to read your word. Praise Jesus. And here he is. He threw them, these three men, and then the ones that the fire kindled on them. Verse 23. So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, securely tied, fell into the roaring flames. But suddenly, don't we love those suddenlies?
Yes.
Remember when the disciples were in the upper room, and suddenly they were tarrying, waiting for the baptism of the Holy Ghost with fire and speaking in tongues. All of a sudden, there was a suddenly.
Amen.
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 You can be in a situation and God will be there. There will be a suddenly that comes upon you. I love that. Be in my house and just doing dishes I don't do dishes, but you know, loading the dishes and whatever I'm doing. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden, there's a suddenly. The Holy Ghost will just fall on you. Driving in your car, there's a suddenly. Don't quench that. Don't quench that. When those suddenlies come through the Holy Ghost and the Holy Spirit begins to fall on you and the anointing falls on you, do not quench the Spirit of the living God.
Amen.
If laughter comes upon you, let it come and let it come expressively.
Amen.
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 If you feel that crying up coming in you and there's such an intense tearing up, do not quench it. You're quenching the very Spirit of the Lord. You got to keep yourself emotionally. No one can. Who cares who sees you?
Really?
I've been in my car and just people looking at me like I am from another planet. I'm over there in my car. Oh my God, thank you, Lord. Praise you, Father. The Lord is sharing something with me. I don't care who's around. I'm just praising and thanking God. And then there's times, just intense crying. You know, whatever it is. Do not quench the Spirit of the Lord. Those are the suddenlies. So here we are, verse 24. But suddenly, Nebuchadnezzar jumped up in amazement and exclaimed to his advisors, "Didn't we tie up 3 men and throw them into the furnace?" "Yes, your majesty, we certainly did," they replied. "Look, look," Nebuchadnezzar shouting. He shouted, "I see 4 men, unbound, walking around in the fire, unharmed. Woo! And the 4th looks like a god."
Amen.
Hallelujah. This really happened. Threw 3 men in there. And now there's a 4th one in there. And Nebuchadnezzar doesn't know what to do. He's amazed. The amazement, if you go into translation, the Hebrew translation, he was terrified. Let's keep reading. So in verse 26, he says, "The 4th looks like a god." Then Nebuchadnezzar came as close as he could to the door. He didn't want to get burned up. Of the flaming furnace and shouted, "Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the Most High God." Woo! "Come out and come here." So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego stepped out of the fire. Hallelujah. The Lord says, amen. Some of y'all are about to step out of the fire.
Amen.
Y'all been in the fire, and the Lord says it's been by design, and he says you're going to step out that fire, and you're going to be unharmed.
Amen.
Praise Jesus.
Amen.
So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego stepped out of the fire. Then the high officers, officials, governors, and advisors crowded around them. They wanted to see these men and saw that the fire had not touched them. Not a hair on their heads was singed. And their clothing was not scorched. They didn't even smell of smoke.
Amen.
Woo! Hallelujah.
Amen.
And if you go up where it says the 4th looks like a god in verse 25, in translation it says the angel of the Lord in deity. Amen. Angelic form, that's deity. Some commentators believe, some scholars believe that was Christ in that fire with them.
Amen.
Amen.
I want to share, Saint, with you that when you're in the fire and you're in the furnace and it feels like all hope is lost, I want you to know that you're not in that fire alone. Jesus is there with you.
Amen.
Christ is there with you.
Amen.
Now, the representation of who Christ is in the earth today is who? The Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Amen. But the Holy Ghost is not going to go into mess either, so you have to know that as well. Praise God.
Amen.
He'll back away. One more scripture and we'll close it up. Praise Jesus. Isn't that good? That's good, Pastor.
Yes.
That's good. That's good, Pastor. Hallelujah. Zechariah 13:9. Let's go to old Zechariah and see what Mr. Zechariah's got to say. Don't think it's strange, saints. These trials are good for us. They help us to rely on the Lord. They help us to endure. They help us to mature in our
Amen.
Faith. It gets the garbage out of us, too.
Amen.
Amen. Zechariah, right before the New Testament. Zechariah and Malachi. Zechariah, Malachi, New Testament. Amen.
Amen.
These are the minor prophets. The minor prophets just means that their books are really small. Doesn't mean minor in power or the things they did. These were mighty men of God. Zechariah 13:9. Are we there? We're gonna leave with this scripture because it's an amazing scripture. Are we all there? Because I want us all to read this. This is powerful. Zechariah said, "I will bring that group. I will bring the hand of God ministry. I will bring the church on Smyrna. I will bring the church on Schumacher Lane through the fire."
Amen.
And the fire's purpose is what? To make them pure.
Amen.
Woo! Hallelujah. "I will refine them like silver and purify them like gold. They will call on my name and I will answer them. I will say that these are my people, and they will say the Lord is our God."
Amen.
Close it. You can close your Bible. Isn't that just a good way to end it right there?
Hallelujah.
He says, "I will be with you when you go through the fire."
Oh, amen.
So don't think it's strange, saints. The fiery trials that are to test us. Amen.
Hallelujah.
We stay trusting God. We stay trusting the Father. We stay trusting the Lord. Make up in your heart and mind. I'm going to seek you, Lord. I'm going to search for you, Lord, with all my heart, all my mind, and all my soul. I'm going to study. I'm going to seek your word. And I'm going to pray. I'm going to make a conscious effort every day upon rising to connect with you. In your car, in your closet, wherever you have alone time, I want you as a believer to make a conscious effort to spend time with God this week. And my second request, and I want to charge you with this, is invite people. Just start inviting people.
Amen.
One plants, another waters, but God gives the increase. It's not up to you whether they come or not. Your job is just to plant and to water. That's it. You throw and you cast your line out, and if they come, great, wonderful. They don't, do not take it personal. Amen?
Amen.
They're not rejecting you. Rejecting him.
Sometimes it feels like I'm watching from the outside. Sometimes it feels like I'm breathing. But am I alive? I won't keep searching for answers that aren't here to find.